Wisconsin can be so cold. The scales of justice can erode. If we accept lies big and bold, we forget we live on Avery Road.
Hello everybody, this is Eric Kose on Making a Murderer on YouTube. I cover the Stephen Avery and Brendan Dassey cases, but also as time passes I've been covering other cases such as the staircase or OJ and many wrongful convictions of youth. I go over the documents, the photos, the videos, anything case related. So stay tuned, because I have many more videos, just like the one you're about to see. Hello, everybody. Okay, we're here today. We're going to be talking about Zellner's main suspects. Also, I'm going to throw in probably a little bit about Michael Osmundson. So what we're going to go through first right now is one of the Zellner filings. And what I'm going to be showing you a lot is Zellner's filings here. What you're going to be able to do with this is you're going to be able to see what she's talking about. She's going to reference things in the documents, in the investigation reports, and that sort of stuff. And you will be able to go, and you'll be able to, I'm going to leave you the link to the StephenAveryCase.org down below here. And you can go to that site, and you can find the documents you're looking for. You can find the documents you're looking for there. And you can look into some of these things if you're looking to do that. So these documents are going to refer to a lot of things that you can potentially look into for yourself. So that's why I wanted to give you guys that link below. So this first document is going to be going into basically the Fassbender. It's going to be dealing with the Brady violation of the CD and the computer evidence. Now, in the process of doing that, it talks a lot about what's on that computer and what's on that and all that stuff, right? So it's going to be talking about what's there, why it implicates Bobby and that sort of stuff. And we're just going to get a lot of information here about this Brady violation and why it's so important, why it's getting talked about, and why it makes Bobby such a big suspect when it comes down to it. The other thing that this is going to be pointing out to you is how the state was. There's no way about it. The courts may be willing, I hope they aren't, but they may be willing to sign off on this. But what the state was doing with this evidence was absolutely horrible. It was absolutely, they were absolutely playing games with it. They were absolutely doing everything they could to make sure Dean and Jerry couldn't actually review it before Denny was due. I mean, you'll see in all the tactics they were using. And then throughout this video, we're going to also go on to talk about Ryan. We're going to see what Zellner has been saying, had to say about Ryan in some of her filings, and that sort of stuff. This video is going to run a bit long. But I think you guys won't mind, because it's going to be a premiere, and that's just going to create more time for the chat, for everybody to be able to talk in the chat, right? So that this is going to be covering the main suspects. So we'll move into the first bit right now, where it basically kind of goes over this Brady violation, why it's important, how it implicates Bobby, and that sort of stuff. So here we go. The Fassbender report refers to examination of Brendan Dassey's computer, emphasis added. There is absolutely no proof that the computer belonged to Brendan Dassey, and there is proof that it was primarily used by his brother Bobby. The Fassbender report minimizes the number of violent pornographic images, the severity of the violent pornographic images, and incriminating word searches that demonstrate an obsession with inflicting pain on young females, dead female bodies, and mutilating female bodies. The Fassbender report also ignores the timeline of the images being viewed, which excludes other family members and incriminates Bobby. The Fassbender report refers to a few messages of Brendan about whether he thought Mr. Avery was guilty of the Halbach murder, while ignoring Bobby's prolific, graphic, and sexually aggressive messages to underage girls. The Fassbender report conspicuously omits the date of May 10, 2006, which is when Detective Veely completed the Veely final investigative report and downloaded it onto a CD. He omits the day that the original forensic examination of the computer, he omits that day from his report, so that, as to hide the fact that the CD exists, right? On December 15th of 2006, Prosecutor Kratz sent Attorney String an itemized inventory of our Stephen Avery file. In the inventory, Prosecutor Kratz references 7 CDs, contents of Brendan Dassey's computer. Again, this statement is completely misleading to the defense because 7 DVDs were disclosed that could not be opened without the NCASE program. But the CD, which required no specialized software, was not disclosed. On December of... So, you see what they're getting at there. That Kratz was talking about 7 CDs, but there was actually 7 DVDs, and the CD was not included, which wouldn't have required going and getting this NCASE program and learning how to use it and do all that. So, you see that there's a game being played by Ken Kratz and Tom Fassbender. Tom Fassbender in his report, omitting the day that the forensic report of the computer was completed and things like that. So you see a culmination here of things. Anyway, on December 19th of 2006, Attorney String had his paralegal send 7 DVDs to Attorney Jerome Buting. But no CD is referenced in her letter because trial defense counsel had not been provided with this CD. Attached and incorporated herein as Exhibit 4 is the December 19th, 2006 letter of paralegal Shavon Ryan to Attorney Buting documenting 7 DVDs, which attached photocopies of the DVDs. Because Special Agent Fassbender kept the CD in his possession, trial defense counsel only received the 7 DVDs. There was not time for the trial defense counsel to retain a forensic computer expert and perform the forensic analysis on the 7 DVDs, which took Detective Vili 16 days. By the January 10th, 2007 due date for the trial defense counsel to file their State versus Denny. So by the time they got all these DVDs and everything, they didn't even have enough time to examine them in order to use them to put up other suspects and besides Steven that could have possibly done this that might have motive. So these DVDs were handed over in where they required a special program called NCASE to examine them. And like it says there, it took Detective Vili 16 days to compile all that information and put it on these DVDs and stuff. And the defense just wouldn't have had enough time to examine it in time to meet the Denny deadline. So that's highly interesting. January 10th, 2007, the due date for the trial's defense counsel, State versus Denny. Additionally, because they were not provided with the CD, with a CD, with the Vili final investigative report, which contained this criteria, word searches, registry, recovered pornography, internet history, Windows registry, and all MSN images, they could not effectively use this information to impeach Bobby or establish a motive to the murder of Miss Halbach pursuant to Denny. The murder of Miss Halbach pursuant to Denny. Attached and incorporated is Mr. Hunt's affidavits. On January 25th of 2007, on the eve of trial, Attorney String received a document entitled Stipulation Project from Prosecutor Kratz. In that document, paragraph R stated, computer analysis of Steve, Teresa's, and Brendan's computer. Mike Vili, SIC. Of the Grand Chute PD, analyzed the hard drives of these three and found nothing of evidentiary value. That's what Ken Kratz said. In terms of discovery, in my opinion, that's what Ken Kratz was saying, that there was nothing of evidentiary value on those hard drives. Yet, they're playing all these games with the DVDs and the CD and the and everything with the supposed Brendan Dassey computer. Sounds fishy to me. Let's see here. We may wish to introduce the fact that they looked. This stipulation eliminates Officer Vili as needing Officer Vili as a witness. And then here in Exhibit 5 is Ken Kratz's stipulation project. On January 30th, 2007, Judge Willis denied trial defense counsel's Denny motion because there was no proof of motive for the murder provided by trial defense counsel. On February 5th of 2007, jury selection began for Mr. Avery's trial. So that is, to me, very interesting here, because you see this game that Ken Kratz and Tom Fassbender are playing with this CD. This CD certainly would have allowed them to meet Denny. I mean, Willis states as much that, you know, because they try to say that he was wrong in determining that they didn't have anybody that met Denny or whatever, and Willis kept sticking to the fact that you don't have motive. Well, had they had this CD and, you know, and all that, they would have been able to establish motive. So it's going to be interesting to see where this all ends up. I am sorry that one was so long, but there's a lot of information there really to digest. So you get number one, the Fassbender report, okay, that the state is going to be referring to highly because it was handed over on December 9th, which is essentially a month before Denny was due, but it was completely whitewashed. Who else from the DOJ do we know that whitewashes things? Oh, yes, Peg L. Peg L likes to whitewash things. Must be something in the training over there at the DOJ, maybe. I don't know. But anyways, that report clearly whitewashes everything. It whitewashes. It downplays the violence in the images. It downplays the youth of the women in the images. It downplays, I mean, everything that is alarming about what was found there. That Fassbender report is basically downplaying it and whitewashing it. And also, it's referring to it as Brendan's computer, not the Dassey computer. Okay, there's no real evidence that Brendan used it. So it's pointing out so we first of all have that, the Fassbender whitewashing. Okay, then it gets to the fact of the games that Ken Kratz and basically Tom Fassbender were playing with this evidence, in terms of, you know, they had it on April 26th of 2006. Okay, they held on to it for 8 months. Yeah. And then suddenly they start handing over the 7 DVDs that have the hard drive, an imprint of the hard drive on these 7 DVDs that if you have this, you know, you use this special programming case and examine it or whatever. But you really kind of need to be an expert to do that. So they hand over these 7 DVDs that they've had for 8 months with 3 weeks to go before Denny. Okay. So you understand the thing here. They're trying to jam up the defense. The defense, number one, which is low on money, and the state probably realized that too. But jams them up like this with only 3 weeks left, making it almost impossible for Dean and Jerry to discern whether or not there's anything there that they need to bring a computer expert into and analyze it. And as you're going to hear Dean say right now, he honestly wasn't thinking about looking there because he figured the rules of discovery that Ken Kratz had been saying that there was nothing of evidentiary value there, and kind of just by the rules of discovery, he feels like he was being deceived. That it totally seems like deception by the state. And I agree. So we're going to get into that, you know, here in a second with what Dean said about that. But the important thing here is why Bobby and then being connected to Bobby Scott are becoming the big suspects here, or among the big suspects, is that this computer evidence was so desperately trying to be hidden by the state. It's obvious that that's what was happening. So this is how this all connects up. It's all, I think, all part of the mosaic of understanding the current suspects. So right now we're going to hear from Dean, basically a direct statement from Dean himself about what he feels went down with the prosecution and with this computer evidence and all that sort of stuff. So we'll get to that now. On June 27th of 2018, current post-conviction counsel received an affidavit from Attorney Strang. In the affidavit, Mr. Strang concludes that he and Mr. Buting were deceived by Prosecutor Kratz regarding the importance of the Dassey CD. These are Dean Strang's words. I accepted without challenge Ken Kratz's assertion in a January 25, 2007 email to me that Veeley's analysis of Steve, Teresa's, and Brendan's computers yielded nothing much of evidentiary value. With the belated production of the Veeley forensic analysis to the Mr. Avery's current lawyers in April of 2018, it now appears to me from the materials that Ms. Zellner and co-counsel have filed that the Vili forensic analysis is in fact did include much of evidentiary value in direct contradiction to Mr. Kratz's claim. Given what I know now about the existence and the content of the Vili forensic analysis, this looks to me like deceit. It looks like deceit about who used the computer. It looks like deceit about the evidentiary value of the information extracted from the computer. At a minimum, it looks like material information bearing on innocence that the state knowingly possessed, had exclusively in its possession, and withheld from the defense. So, those are the words of Dean Strang himself. So, here's Zellner citing a little case law that y'all might find interesting. The Wisconsin Supreme Court in Harris stated, "We agree with Harris that here, the undisclosed information is favorable to the accused because it casts doubt on the credibility of the state's primary witnesses." So, as Harris illustrates, favorable evidence includes impeachment evidence, and the failure to disclose impeachment evidence has been uniformly recognized as a Brady violation by the United States Supreme Court. In Weary versus Kane. Now, the interesting thing here and why she's bringing this up is because the state is claiming that you can only have a Brady violation with exculpatory evidence, and that's why Zellner's claims are invalid. And here's Zellner putting the case law right there, where you see the Wisconsin Supreme Court itself in Harris stated that we agree with Harris here, that the undisclosed information is favorable to the accused and it casts doubt on the credibility of the state. So that's impeachment evidence, not exculpatory evidence. So that's the interesting thing here, folks. Citing the Wisconsin Supreme Court itself, I think, is powerful. I think that's going to hold some weight. Okay, so that's, I think, when we talk about this and we talk about this, this evidence, we talk about, Bobby and stuff, I think it's important to understand the games that the state was playing. So that's why I wanted you to hear from Dean Strang there and really get a good idea of what's going on there. So then we move on now to what we're going to be talking about, which is Zellner brings up Mike Osmunson and talks more about Bobby and, Bobby and Mike Osmunson. And so it's mainly about this statement that's attributed that Mike Osmunson said happened on the 10th, which is impossible. Couldn't have happened on the 10th because Stephen Avery was in custody on the 9th. He was arrested and in custody on the 9th. So there's no way that there's that little anomaly to begin with, Michael Osmunson thinking it happened on a day that it couldn't have possibly happened. Then we have Bobby Dassey in court who suddenly tries to move it, this conversation happening all the way to November 4th, which is before the RAV is found. Teresa's still a missing person, and he's coming in there asking if Steven has her in a closet or whatever. I mean, it's just weird that he's coming in and asking about Teresa, or whatever. So, and then it goes that Avery makes the joke of, haha, yeah, you want to help me bury the body or whatever. It's strange, but the thing is that this evidence is coming in through Bobby Dassey, who was actually on the other side of the garage, supposedly where the deer was, and he was trying to relay this conversation in court as if it was between him and Steven, basically, when it was actually between Michael Osmunson and Steven. So why all this jankiness around this statement? And why is the prosecution playing games and trying to bring this in through Bobby instead of through Michael, who the conversation with Stephen, whom it actually happened, because they didn't want Dean and Jerry to be able to cross-examine Michael Osmunson? Could that be it? So, I mean, it's just all very odd. And so we'll move into it now.
November 14, 2005, in an interview with CCSD, Calumet County Sheriff's Department, Mike Osmunson, Bobby's friend, claimed that he had been at the Avery property one time on November 10th, 2005. Mr. Osmunson indicated he was aware Stephen was one of the last people to see the missing girl and jokingly asked Stephen if Stephen has her, the missing girl, in a closet. Mr. Osmunson claimed that Mr. Avery then asked him if he wanted to help bury the body, and that they had laughed about it together. In the 11-14-05 CCSD interview of Mike Osmundson, clearly Mr. Osmundson's story was fabricated because Mr. Avery was arrested and in custody beginning on November 9th of 2005. At trial, Bobby contradicted Mr. Osmundson's police report and testified that Mr. Avery made a comment to them about getting rid of a body on November 4th of 2005. Mr. Avery, in his most recent affidavit, disputes the content of this conversation. Mr. Avery contends that it was Bobby and Mr. Osmundson that asked him if he knew how to get rid of a body. Mr. Avery believes that it is highly suspicious that Bobby and Mr. Osmundson were referring to a body on November 4th, 2005, since the investigation at that point in time was for a missing person. In his Calumet County Sheriff's Department interview on November 17th of 2017, Bobby claimed that he had never hunted on the Redant property, in the Manitowoc gravel pit, or in the area off Cuss Road in Two Rivers. Mr. Avery has given an affidavit that directly contradicts Bobby's statements and claimed that Bobby frequently hunted in the Manitowoc gravel pit area. So this is very interesting, folks, and I'm now going to go and tell you a little bit more about Michael Osmundson. That's it could be very relevant, put it that way. Okay, so the interesting thing to know about Michael Osmundson really is that Stephen was also seeing a Marie Avery. She was not a blood relation, but he was seeing her, and she was about Michael's age, roughly. And Michael had a bit of a crush on her. He was at least infatuated at the time or whatever. So knowing that, knowing the strange statements that are getting made on the wrong days that don't make sense, and just the general oddness going on around this particular statement, create confusion and create, you know, a lot of things. So I just feel it's important to mention that Michael did have an emotional attachment to somebody that could have given him a potential reason to want to see Stephen go away, at the very least. Okay, so a few final things to talk about when it comes to Bobby and obviously Scott is the fact that the RAV4 was seen over by this dam, over by this service station, and somebody who knew Scott actually had seen it. I had seen that RAV. And when they went to this gas station or whatever, they saw one of the flyers. And so they actually went inside and told a sheriff's officer that they had seen this RAV4 up the road or whatever. This was on November 3rd, I believe it was, he went and made him aware of this. Now, this person told that deputy, moved on, right, with his life. Then he was sitting down watching Making a Murderer in 2015, and he saw that sheriff's deputy on the stand in Making a Murderer. It was Colburn that he had told about the RAV4 that he had seen over by the dam on the 3rd. This guy, he knew, he'd known Scott. He tried to tell Scott, hey, Scott, you know what? I had seen that car, and I had told Colburn about it or whatever. And this guy tried to reach out to Scott and tell Scott first, but Scott basically said he was sick and ignored the guy. The guy eventually got into contact with Zellner himself. And that's how Zellner knew about that. So there's that going on with the RAV4, with Colburn, with the guy that was trying to contact Scott, and Scott kind of didn't follow up with the guy at all, and the guy ended up calling Zellner himself. So there's many of these little strange things. There's the timing of the way that Bobby left exactly the same time as Teresa. That's also strange. The fact that he was looking out the windows and like knew everything about her when she came, knew everything she was wearing. I mean, this to me suggests a fixation potentially. The way that it goes down. And you know, the quickest shower of all time before he gets out to his blazer to leave. I mean, it looks like he was trying to hurry and make sure that he could follow her when she left by the way he was looking out the windows. I mean, there's just significant strangeness there to warrant, you know, suspicion. So, yeah, there's all these things about, you know, there's the blazer now supposedly caught fire and was crushed.
Scott's trailer, which did apparently catch fire and everything. So, I mean, it's weird that things connected with these two gentlemen are catching on fire. And then, you know, the blaze are getting crushed. And, you know, it's just, these are all things that are being noticed by Zellner, and she's not missing a beat. So she's trying to create reasonable doubt for her client, and that's what she's going to do. And that's where this is at. So now we're going to go ahead and move into Ryan Hillegass. So the first thing we're going to show you is going to be the Ryan's hands. Now, some of you will think, oh yeah, those marks on his one hand. Yeah, those are significant. And I'm going to show you those. But the other thing that's significant is what I want you to look at is you're going to see a picture of Ryan's hand right now. And it's going to be in the picture kind of like this, where you're going to see it where the pinky side right here, right? It's actually going to be more like this, kind of a downward angle on it. And I want you to look at his hand right here and tell me if you don't see like bruising on that part of his hand, like right here. Okay, I want you to tell me if you see that in this picture that we're coming up, because a lot of people are suggesting that is bruised, and it looks bruised, so it could have been from a fight or an altercation or something like that. So I'm going to show you that, and then we're also going to see where the scratches are supposed to be, like right here, where it looks like somebody like fingernails like scratched right there on his hand. Whoops, sorry, wrong way. So they're going to look like little scratches right. You know, right here or whatever. So you'll see that right now, and then we'll come on back. Okay, so I think you can see what I mean there on the heel of his hand. It looks like bruising right there in the bottom pictures. And then obviously we move on to this where you see down in the bottom there where it looks like somewhat like scratches maybe or something on his hand down there that look like evenly spaced. Okay, so Ryan's hands, obviously, that's the first thing with Ryan that you know you would want to point out. I'm going to try and focus on the things that weren't really focused on much in MAM2 and stuff. Obviously, you all know about him claiming that the headlamp was, or I'm sorry, the blinker lamp was, that Teresa had made a claim for it, got a lump sum, and just never replaced it, which has turned out to be completely untrue. You know that he had a page of her day planner that she had handwritten in that day, so you know that. So you know those things about Ryan, right? And so that's established. But so there we go. We have him at the time, what his hands look like. Interesting, right? Now we're going to move into his testimony at trial, and we're going to give you a little bit of an education here about what duping delight is, and then you're going to see a couple instances of Ryan displaying it. So we'll move into that now.
They're red flags. We're human beings. We make deceptive, flailing gestures all over the place all day long. They don't mean anything in and of themselves. But when you see clusters of them, that's your signal. Look, listen, probe, ask some hard questions, get out of that very comfortable mode of knowing, walk into curiosity mode, ask more questions, have a little dignity, treat the person you're talking to with rapport. Don't try to be like those folks on Law and Order and those other TV shows that pummel their subjects into submission. Don't be too aggressive. It doesn't work. Now, we've talked a little bit about how to talk to someone who's lying and how to spot a lie. This mother, Diane Downs, shot her kids at close range, drove them to the hospital while they bled all over the car, claimed a scraggy-haired stranger did it. And you'll see when you see the video, she can't even pretend to be an agonizing mother. What you want to look for here is an incredible discrepancy between horrific events that she describes and her very, very cool demeanor. And if you look closely, you'll see duping delight throughout this video.
But at night, when I close my eyes, I can see Christy reaching her hand out to me while I'm driving, and the blood just keep coming out of her mouth. And that, maybe it'll fade too with time, but I don't think so. That haunts me the most.
And after telling that story, this is the look on Diane Downs' face. It's quite amazing. But anyways, Ryan has a similar look. Okay, so that was from a TED Talk video. I will try to make sure I get that link and leave it below there. Brilliant video about lie detection, about deception in general, detecting deception. And then that little part where she's explaining duping delight really fits in to help us understand with Ryan here. So now I'm going to show you a couple pictures of Ryan at trial so that you can see that very similar look that you saw on Diane Downs just a second ago. You're going to see a look, a smirk that's very, very similar. A couple different smirks from Ryan that are very similar to that. So here we go. So here we have Ryan with a bit of a dupe smirk, kind of, you know, it's kind of just a smirk, not a full-on smile. But then we get to the part here where he's describing making up a username and that or whatever. Now here he is just, it's like he's just totally amusing himself. He is just like having a blast right there. And anyways, that is just, I don't understand it. This is his friend that is dead. Okay, and so now for our final clip of Ryan here, we're going to see more of Ryan just acting shady, acting like dodgy. Dodgy is a really good word that I like to use for Ryan, because it really does sum him up in a lot of ways really well. So we're going to see a clip here of him talking news to the news people, and looking very dodgy. And don't forget to take a look at Mike Halbach during this clip, because he fills me with just as much angst and apprehension as listening and watching Ryan in this clip. So here we go.
Find anything while you were out searching?
I'm not really going to comment on that, but if anything was found, you know, we had proper authority and professionals take a look at it as they needed.
How many times were you on the site tonight? You were there Saturday when they found the car, but how many other times were you on the site?
I wasn't on the site. That's not true at all.
Did you get their mic? Were you part of the on the site search?
We have no. The people. I mean, the original when we originally found the vehicle was a member of our search party.
It was a member of our
who
search
asked
party.
Permission to go onto the site, but no one other than that has ever been on the
original. On the actual site. It's been crime scene and taped off, secured.
Okay, so that, you know, that pretty much sums up the basics on the main suspects in this case, the main persons of interest in this case. Obviously, this will set up the discussion for tomorrow night's live. Hope you guys enjoyed it. Hope the discussion will continue to go on in the in the live chat for a while after this premiere ends. I know you guys all do like to talk and discuss the case in there for a while after the video is done, so feel free to do so. In fact, I encourage you to do so. If you haven't already, please hit subscribe, and we'll see you.